Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we pray that your kingdom would come and your will would be done here on this earth as it is in heaven, and not just on this earth, but specifically in each one of our hearts. As we submit to you, Father, we pray that you would fill us with your spirit, that you would give us ears to hear what you would say to us through your word, that you would guide and direct Ben as he shares the word. You give him the words to speak and the spirit and the heart with which to speak them, so that we would hear from you and that we would hear your truth, and that we would hear your grace, and that we would hear your heart, and that we would respond and leave changed and different than the way that we came in. We just ask your blessing upon the rest of the service and pray that your kingdom would come and that your will be done in our hearts today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Before you sit, English is hard. Take a moment and greet those who are around you this morning. Let them know you're glad to see them here today. Before we dive into our study of the Word today, I want to give a few announcements. Today, after the service is over, we have a church council meeting at 11:30. So church council, 11:30 in the library. If you guys got a chance to look at your bulletin, you'll see that we have information about our pastoral search committee, the people who were voted into those positions. Be praying for them. They will need your prayer over the course of the next few months. Pray for safety for Jason and Charlotte. If you guys are, if you've been here, you know that Jason and Charlotte Bachman went up to Canada in order to install a new sound system in Camp of the Woods. It went really well. Jason got that installed. He sent me pictures and everything yesterday, and so that went real well. He's going to spend the next couple days working around the camp, and then they'll come home on Tuesday. So pray for Jason and Charlotte as they are on their way home. If you have not yet submitted a directory photo for our church directory, we do the online photo directory app on your phone. So if you have not given one of those, you see the information on there, send a picture to Dorothy. She'll get it placed in there, and then we'll have you. That way other people can see who you are. June 20th, we have our next senior and retired adults luncheon at El Rio. If you are wanting to be baptized, you know, I've had several requests for baptism over the course of the past few weeks. Before we leave and go back to Alabama, we're going to be doing several baptisms on different Sundays here. The first one that we're going to be doing is going to be next week on Father's Day. We're going to do a couple baptisms on Father's Day. But if you are somebody, you've placed your faith in the Lord, you have not yet followed the Lord in baptism, and you would like me to baptize you before we leave, I would be happy to do that. Just contact me and let me know, and we will get that scheduled. I'm going to let Callie come up for just a minute here, and she is going to give some announcements about Family Camp. Family Camp is just a couple weeks away, 21st of this month. So, Callie, announcement. Topher, she's on my mic.
Am I good? Oh, yeah. Okay. Good morning. Yep, went completely blank. Like you said, it's in about 2 weeks, and we're super excited. It's a lot of fun. One thing I want to remind, that if you can't come camp, you can come up for the day. It's just right up in Alta Sierra. It's easy to come up and hang out with us for all day, for a few hours. I encourage you to come up Saturday night for the talent show. I want you to participate in the talent show. It's a lot of fun. It's not serious. It's fun. It's silly. One year I made animal sounds. Like, so whatever you think is fun, you think you could show off, especially encourage your kids to do that. We're going to start working on cabin assignments and start signing up for meals. So when we're up there, what we do is everyone that's there helps with a meal. So you either help cook the meal or you help clean up, so that we're all working and doing. It's not just a few people doing all of the things to make camp run. think that was it.
Money's due.
If you have any questions, just let me know, and we can sort it out and figure it out. But yeah, we're super excited. We hope you come join us, and we'll see you in a couple weeks. It is. It's a lot cooler up there, too. So if you want to just come hang out in the cooler air.
It'll be fun. Money is due on the 16th. And then the final announcement is Vacation Bible School is coming up in the beginning of July, July 4th through 6th. That's a Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. VBS will be in the evening on the 4th and 5th. And then on the morning of the 6th, we have the pool over there at South Fork Elementary School Middle School reserved. So we're having a pool party and a barbecue for all the kids and the families. And so we're moving Vacation Bible School over to that side of the lake to try to reach out into that community there in South Lake, Weldon area. So if you want to be a part of it, or if you're like, well, I don't know that I can get my kids over there. If your kids need a ride, we can provide that as well. So you can sign up in your bulletin. You'll see a little QR code there. Just scan that with your phone. That'll take you to the registration. And then also, we need workers. So on your way out this morning, I think the sign-up sheets for both family camp and for Vacation Bible School are on the coffee stand out there. So on your way out, go and sign up for those, and then we'll get your kids registered, and it'll be a great time. Or if you'd like to work, Lacey still needs some helpers on that, so sign up. It's going to be a lot of fun. It'll be a good time. So those are the announcements. If you've got your Bible this morning, turn to the book of Matthew. Book of Matthew, chapter 14, is where we're going to be today. Matthew chapter 14. Now, the miracle story that we are going to be diving into this week is one that is especially meaningful to my family. About 9 years ago, in 2015, summer of 2015, spring of 2015, we were looking for a pastoral position. I knew in coming out of seminary that eventually God was going to lead me to pastor a church, but I was serving as an assistant pastor in a church, and so we had started looking around for pastoral positions. A friend of mine had directed me to stop just looking in the places I was looking and look some other areas. That's how we ended up looking out in California, and in 2015, we stumbled upon the job posting for this church here. And so I applied for this. It took a little bit, but eventually they got back with me. I answered a bunch of questions, and then they wanted to do an interview. So we did an interview over Skype, and when the interview was over, Heather and I both said the same thing. We think that might be the place. We think that might be the place where God is leading us to go into pastor a church. And so they contacted us again, and they said, we would like for you to come out and candidate for this position. We'd like you to come out here. We'll pay for you to come out, and you can come and preach to the congregation and see if they would like to bring you out. But then they gave us this caveat. Here's the only problem. We know that we can't pay you what it takes for you to live here. So for us, that was the conundrum, right? Is like we think this is a great church. We think this would be a good connection point. But here's the problem. We can pay you. We just don't think we can pay you as much as it's going to cost for you to live here. So Heather and I, we had actually planned on, or I was on my way out to go to Chicago. I was taking a group of college students on a inner city mission trip. We were going to go down into Humboldt Park, which is a bad neighborhood in Chicago, and do some outreach work. And so Heather and I determined, let's pray over the course of this week while I'm in Chicago, you're here in Alabama. We'll pray, and then we'll come back together at the end of this week, and we'll see if God is telling us anything. So we took off. I was in Chicago every day full of work, but every morning I'd get up and I would pray and I would read my Bible and I was just listening for God. And about the second day that I was there, I was reading a passage not related to the passage we're looking at today, and three words just popped in my mind, and they would not leave me alone. And they were simply the words, fishes and loaves. And this just, it just embedded itself in my heart. And all week long, it just kept coming back to that, fishes and loaves. And that leads me back to the story in Matthew chapter 14, which is the story of the fishes and the loaves and the feeding of the 5,000. So I came home from Chicago. I went to my wife and I said, this is what God has impressed upon my heart over the course of the last week, fishes and loaves. I think what God is telling us is it's time for us to go, and we just need to trust him for the provision of the things that we need. So 8.5 years ago, we left. We came out here to California. We settled in here at this church. And for 8.5 years, God has proven himself over and over and over again faithful to his word, faithful to what he was telling us. And he has provided for us in every way. So fishes and loaves is not just a statement out of a Bible story for us. It's our lived experience. That God has taken the little and the meager and has expanded it in such a way that he has provided for every need that we have. So this morning, we're in Matthew 14, and we're going to be looking at the miraculous story of the feeding of the 5,000. Now, to set up this story, it comes right about midpoint in Jesus' earthly ministry. In chapter 13, Jesus had just been rejected by his hometown. He'd gone to Nazareth, and he had gone there to preach and do his normal work, and they rejected him. That's at the end of chapter 13. Beginning of chapter 14, we hear that John the Baptist has been killed. That's how it begins. That's how chapter 14 begins. We won't get into the whole sordid story, but John the Baptist had made a nuisance of himself to Herod by condemning him for having his brother's wife, and so he had been arrested, and eventually Herod and his new wife, who was his brother's wife, and his stepdaughter had conspired and put John to death. And beheaded him. And so in starting in chapter 14, verse 13, it says, now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. Jesus withdrew to a desolate place by himself. Now, something that we need to state here at the very beginning of this message, in the very beginning of this study, is that we understand the idea of the hypostatic union, right? The hypostatic union is that Christ is fully divine, he's fully man, that he is both existing together. And so while he is fully God, and therefore he has the long view perspective of everything, he's also fully man, which means that Christ in the flesh was subject to emotion and to things like fatigue and tiredness and sadness. And all of this was happening in Christ. We know in John 11:35, it says that when Lazarus died, Jesus wept, right? There is this emotional response that happens when this man that he knows and loves dies. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Christ is praying, and it says that he's sweating great drops of blood. There's a stress that is on him that is so much as he's looking forward to taking the sins of humanity upon himself that he is so stressed that the capillaries are bursting and blood is running from his pores. John was important to Jesus, not just because he was a prophet, not just because he was the precursor to Christ's ministry, but also he was his cousin as well. And so what we see here is that Christ receives this sad news of the death of John the Baptist, and he's just been rejected in his hometown where he grew up. And so that's what leads us into this passage. And Christ gets on this boat to go and to be by himself, presumably to go and pray. This is part of what he would do during his ministry. But what it tells us is that he went by himself, verse 12, but when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. And when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd. So the people that were following after Jesus were not boundaries people, right? They didn't have boundaries. They didn't see, man, Jesus is really going through it right now, so let's leave him alone to himself. No, no, they're right there as soon as he steps off the boat to be in this desolate place by himself. Now, if that was me or if that was you, we might respond in a very negative way to that. Hey, I have just had a really bad day. My cousin, my friend, this fellow minister has just been murdered. I've just been rejected in my hometown. Can you guys just give me some space and leave me alone? But that's not what Jesus does, right? Because it goes on, and this is what it says. And it says, when he went ashore, he saw the great crowd, and he had compassion on them, and he healed their sick. Now, this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to examine the story that comes after this, and we're going to learn a few things about the character and the nature of Christ that are beneficial to us in the way that we interact with him and the way that we face what's going on in our lives and in the world around us. So, starting in verse 15, we're going to read verses 15 through 21. It says, "Now when it was evening, the disciples came to him, and they said, 'This is a desolate place, and the day is now over. Send the crowds away to go into the villages and buy food for themselves.' But Jesus said, 'They need not go away. You give them something to eat.' And they said to him, 'We have only 5 loaves here and 2 fish. And he said, 'Bring them here to me.' And he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and he said a blessing. And then he broke the loaves and he gave them to the disciples. The disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men besides women and children." So this morning, we're going to make 5 observations from this text. And what we begin with is, first of all, a reasonable request. Now, my wife and I, we've been together for 22 years in August. We will have been married for 22 years in August. We've been together, started dating 24 years ago, also in August. And in that time, we have developed ways of communicating with each other without actually having to say things. So if I'm rambling on about something or I'm telling a story that possibly I shouldn't tell, my wife has a look that she gives me, and I know instantly it's either time to move on or shut up altogether, right? Like, I know this signal. And she has a tone that if I ask her something, she may say, "So do you want to do this?" And she will say, "Sure, we can do this." But I hear the tone and I'm like, "Nope, she doesn't want to do this. This is not on the list of things she wants to accomplish today." And then when we're at somebody's house or we're at a party or we're at something else like this, when we're out and about, when she determines it's time to leave, I know. And she doesn't have to say a word, right? Because there are little things that she does. The tap on the leg. There's the tap on the foot. There's these little signals and signs that she passes on that say, guess what? It's time to go. The disciples here, as they're out with Jesus, spending this day out there healing people and all of this, they get to that point where they've determined, Jesus, it's time to go. It's time for us to be done here. They're watching the sun start to set. They knew that Jesus was exhausted on multiple levels. They knew what it would take for these people to get back to where they were going. And so they determined, it's time to wrap this up. You guys ever been to like Costco or one of those stores where there's a long line and the checkout guy is getting ready for his break and they determine that somewhere in that line it's breaking and all of you behind the line, you guys are going to go find another line and everybody in front, right? They put the little checkout sign down and let you know this register's closed. That's the disciples. The miracle register's closing, guys. It's time to be done. Jesus is done healing people today. We're done. Now, like, they couch it in better terms than that, because when you hear what they say, they say, "This is a desolate place, the day is now over, and send the crowds away into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus, everyone's hungry, it's late, it's time to just, like, be merciful, release these guys, let them go so that they can go and get something to eat. That's how they couch it. Couch is a benefit for the people. Now, we don't know if that was their real motive, because I think all of us have been in a place where we've been there for long enough and we're like, it is time to be done. It seems to me that this is where the disciples are. It's a reasonable request by this crew. Let's shut it down for the night, Jesus. It's getting late. We've been here for a while. You've been here for a while. So they have a reasonable request, but that reasonable request is answered with what seems to be an unreasonable command. Jesus tells them they don't need to go away. You give them something to eat. You feed them. In recent years, we've started doing something when we prepare to go on mission trips. We started doing community meals. So a couple years ago, we did a spaghetti dinner, and then last year, we did an Asian food dinner. And when you do those kind of things, it takes a lot of planning, right? You got to get a lot of people together. You got to figure out how much the food costs. You got to get the food together. You got to find people who are willing to help you or donate things, and then you've got to prepare. And this is to feed 100 or 200 people. And every time we would would do these meals. It went really well. It brought in a lot of money. It helped us propel the mission. But after every one of them, we were exhausted. And, you know, immediately after it's done, there's always people that say, oh, you know what we should do next year? And you know what I wanted to say? There is no next year. There is only right now. I am exhausted. Let me go home and sleep. It's an exhausting thing. So I want you to imagine the disciples, they're looking out and they're looking at 5,000 people. Well, what it says here is 5,000 men aside from women and children. So there might have been 10 or 15,000 people that are sitting out here and they're looking at that. And that is a much more daunting task than just feeding 100 or 200 people a spaghetti dinner. So I want you to consider why this seems like an unreasonable command. First of all, consider the place. It tells us here that it was a remote or a desolate place. Now, desolate place here does not mean like out in the middle of the Mojave. We under our scales are all messed up because like we live in a huge country, and desolate for us is like if you go out into the middle of the Mojave. Desolate for them, much smaller area. But I want to show you a picture of the Sea of Galilee. So around the Sea of Galilee, this is in the northern part of the sea, it looks very similar to the place that we live, right? And all through the shoreline here, there are little villages. And in between the villages, there are these desolate places where it takes a good long while to get from point A to point B. And so what we see here is Jesus going and finding one of these desolate places to go off and to pray. And that is where the people come to him. So they're often one of these kind of areas, and there may have been villages, but they're not real close by. So he's out in the middle of this. To give you kind of a good scope, if you want to imagine it here, imagine that you're over at Robinson Cove, which just around Sierra Way, you guys know where it's at. It's like two bends around there. And you're at Sierra Way. It's starting to get late, and the people that you're whose house you're at over at Sierra Way are like, oh, we don't have anything to eat. You're going to have to go back into Kernville. You're going to have to walk back into Kernville if you want to get something to eat. That's the scope and scale that we're talking about. So these people, they're going to have to take this hike on this kind of terrain to get out and get back to where they can find something to eat. Villages nearby, but nothing immediately at hand. So the question is, how are we going to get food in here, Jesus? You tell us to give them something to eat, but consider the place where we're at. There's not food readily available. Second of all, consider the time. Now, an important question to consider here. What time of the day do bakers bake? You guys know this, right? Morning, right? Brad, when you're baking bread? Every morning, first thing in the morning. Years ago, our family went to Paris, and you'd get up in the morning, and the city would smell like bread, right? Because everything, it smells like other things at other times, but in the morning, it smelled like bread. And you'd get up, and Parisians, you know, they don't have to go to the store and buy a loaf of bread that was cut like 2 weeks earlier and now is sitting in a plastic bag. They go every morning for the fresh baked bread because it's made fresh every day. So that's when it's baked, is first thing in the morning. And so Jesus telling them here in the late evening to go out and to buy food, to go buy bread, as some of the other gospels let us know, that makes about as much sense as Jesus telling Peter in the morning after he's been fishing all night to let down his nets. It's not the right time. Who's even going to be open? Who's even going to have bread? Who in one of these remote villages is going to have enough bread in the evening time to feed between 5 and 15,000 people? Consider the time, Jesus. Consider the place. And then we have the third part, which is consider the cost. Now, in this gospel, in the gospel of Matthew, we don't have the conversation about money, but in the gospel of Mark, in Mark chapter 6, verse 37, Jesus says, you give them something to eat, and the disciples say, should we go out and spend 200 denarii to give them bread to eat? Now, the denarius was one day's wage for a laborer. So if we want to get some scope on what this would look like in our day and age, a laborer in the United States makes about $17 an hour. So if you work an eight-hour day, that's $136. And so if you multiply that by 200, that's a little over $27,000. So the disciples are saying to Jesus, essentially, Jesus, should we go out and spend $27,000 to feed all of these people? Like, that's unreasonable, right? It's unreasonable to assume that they're going to go and do this. Regardless of the conversion rate, two-thirds of a year's salary is a big deal. And the point is, we don't have the resources, Jesus, to feed all of these people. Now, let me say this as a side note to this, and it'll play in a little bit more as we go on through the message. This is a crucial realization when it comes to accomplishing the things that God calls us to do. It's a crucial realization that we acknowledge that we do not in ourselves have the resources to accomplish the things that God calls us to do. We have to realize this, because if we don't, if we never realize to come to this conclusion, we're going to get to that point where we do things for God and then we pat ourselves on the back because we think somehow we're the ones who accomplished it. God wants us to know that He is the one who provides for us. And if we don't have the means to do it ourselves, and yet it gets done, what does that reveal? It reveals that God has worked in us. Over in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, the apostle Paul, he's got this thorn in the flesh. I've referenced this in a lot of different sermons, but he's got this thorn in the flesh, and he prays to the Lord three times to take it away, and he responds, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." So then Paul responds, "So I will boast all the more in my weakness and calamity in all of these different things." And what he's saying there is that the weaknesses, strength welling up in the middle of these times of calamity and weakness demonstrates that God is actually at work in my life. So he's like, I'm going to rejoice in those times because that's when God's power is shown the most clearly, is when we're at the end of our rope and unable to do something on our own. And it's the same thing that's at work here. If they had had a purse with 50,000 denarii in it or something like this, and they were close by and they could go provide all that stuff for themselves, then God does not get the glory in doing something miraculous. So what we see here is this seemingly unreasonable command because of the time and the place and the cost. These guys knew when Jesus said, "You give them something to eat," that what he was asking was an impossible thing to do. It was impossible. How on earth are they going to do this? And so what that leads to is a fruitless search. So if you look at verse 17, what it tells us here, "And they said to him, 'We only have 5 loaves here and 2 fish.'" Again, in the Gospel of Mark, we get the story here where Jesus tells them to go and see how much. So Matthew redacts it down and just gets to the conclusion. But Mark says, "Go see how much bread we have." So they actually go out and they're scouring through the crowd asking anybody for something. Does anybody have any food? Does anybody have any bread? Anybody have anything? And what they come to the conclusion is, "We have 5 loaves, 2 fish." And when we start talking about loaves and fish, this is what we mean by a loaf, okay? We mean the little round pita bread, okay? When we say a loaf, we imagine this, right? This is the delicious quality pizza bread, Pizza Barn sourdough bread, which as you're seeing it now, I know that it looks delicious, and you can purchase it next door at the Pizza Barn. Doing a commercial for Brad here. That's what we think of when we think of a loaf of bread, right? It's something large, it's something substantial, it's something that can feed multiple people. But go back. What he's talking about is this, little tiny loaves of pita bread there. And so what the Gospel of John tells us is that what they found was not just random bread, it was some kid's lunch. So what they had was what a boy, and it doesn't give us like how old this boy was, but what a boy could eat for lunch and dinner, or lunch or dinner. The other day when Michaela graduated, we went down to That's Italian, and we had dinner down there, and my son Christopher and my nephew Lincoln had sort of a bread eating contest. It was impromptu. They didn't like plan it. It was just as the bread was coming out, they started eating. And eventually they're like, "Hey, Topher's eaten like 6 pieces of bread and Lincoln's on like number 5. And before they were done, they'd each eaten 10 pieces of garlic bread. And then they went on to eat their entrees after this. It was a horrific scene. And at the same time, I was really impressed by it, right? So when we talk about a boy's lunch, you know, that might be quite a bit of food. But let's not pretend that that amount of food is going to feed, you know, 5 people, much less 500 or 5,000 or 5,000 plus the women and children. It's not a huge amount. And this is an important detail because it lets us know that the odds are impossibly stacked against them being able to feed these people. There is no amount of portioning and slicing and all of this that you are going to be able to do to make this work. It's impossible. But it's when the odds are impossible that Jesus does his best work. So they searched. They got the crumbs. There's no way to rationalize that this amount of food, 5 loaves and 2 small fish, are going to feed all of these people. And that's where we get into the miraculous, through divine intervention. Look at verses 18 and 19. It says here, "And Jesus said, 'Bring them here to me.' And then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass, and taking the 5 loaves, the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, and he said a blessing. He broke the loaves, he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowd, and they all ate and were satisfied." So what happens here is the miracle of multiplication by division. Jesus goes and he breaks it down, and as he breaks it down, it becomes more than what it was, and it becomes adequate, and then it becomes more than adequate to feed the people. So let's see the things Jesus does here. First of all, it tells us he blessed. It says that Jesus blessed the bread. He had them sit down, and he looked up to heaven, and he gave a blessing. Now, in his ministry, Jesus personified humility. And one of the things that we see happen with him over and over again is that he gives glory to God the Father constantly. This is part of the setting aside of his glory that it talks about in Philippians chapter 2. In the high priestly prayer of Jesus in John 17, verses 4 and 5, Jesus says to the Father, he says, "I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed." By giving this blessing to begin this meal, he's pointing the direction upward. He's pointing everybody to God the Father to show that what you're about to see, what is about to happen, is not something that any man is doing. This is divine, right? This is divine intervention, that God himself is about to do something in your midst that is going to shock and astound you. So he blesses. Then we see that he broke. It says here in my version, "Then he broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples." Now, grammatically, this is not a verb. It's a participle, which is a verbal helper. The verb is he gave. But the participle, the breaking here, is "and having broken, he gave." And this is in the aorist tense, so it's giving us a sense of it happening, but not telling like how long it took or any of those details. I tend to think that it was maybe a little bit more time-consuming. Anybody here watch The Chosen? You ever see this episode on The Chosen where he goes, he breaks the bread, and then boom, all the little baskets are full, and they're taking around and doing this? I tend to think, and this is just my sanctified imagination, that maybe there's a basket in front of him, and Jesus takes the bread and he begins to tear, and then people are like, "What's taking him so long?" It's just 5 pieces of bread, and he just keeps going and keeps going and keeps going. It's like the magician pulling the handkerchief out of their sleeve, and it just keeps going. Like Jesus keeps producing more and more food, stretching what would feed one person to what would feed 1,000 people. You know, I don't want to get into the mechanics of all of this, because the truth is that the scriptures don't tell us exactly what happens. But you know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of cell division, right? And what happens when you have this one cell and it divides, and now you have 2 cells. So like in conception, there is a fertilized egg, and the fertilized egg then takes and it splits. And as it heads down the fallopian tube, and then it splits again, and then it splits again. And then what was initially this just kind of one thing now begins to grow and become incredibly complex. Like, it's possible that what Jesus is doing is, as he is here splitting this bread, that on a divine level, he is just dividing cells one by one and growing these things right in front of people. And something that is miraculous and scientifically impossible is happening in front of these people, and they're actually watching this occur. I think that's pretty incredible to think about Christ actually doing that and feeding these people. Jesus divided, and the more he divided, the more it grew and grew until there were several thousand times more in front of him than what he started with. Now, This is an important thing for us to recognize here when we see Jesus do this, because what it demonstrates for us is that he has the ability to take that which is small and inconsequential and minuscule and take and multiply it into something that can literally bless thousands. And as sort of a devotional thought here, think about the meager, small things that have been placed into your hands. Think about the meager, small things that God has given to you. You know, we always think about when we came out here, and we think about the fact that God placed in our hands small things, and that through his work, not our work, he has grown those small things into much larger, much more potent, much more powerful things. So what is it in your life that you have and you're like, I just don't have enough, that you could place into the hands of Jesus and watch him multiply into something far more? You think about this just in terms of the blessings he gives us of time and talent and treasure. How can those things be multiplied and maximized? Or even think of the bad things. Think about the needs that you have and the difficulties in your life. Think about the desperate situations, the brokenness. Which of the things that if you place them into his hands, he might multiply those and create blessing out of what seems like nothing? That's the heart of this story here. Is that Jesus has the ability to take that which is inadequate to do what needs to be done and make it beyond what they needed. That is the ability of Christ. He broke the bread, and yet it multiplied. It's a lot like, you know, we just did communion. And in communion, we talk about the breaking of the body. Jesus breaks the bread, it tells us. And then he gives it to them, and he said, this is my body which is broken for you. And Christ's body was broken, and that breaking there was then passed on to not just the people that were in the room, those 12 guys that were sitting around the table, but it has gone to literally billions of people that have been blessed in the breaking of Christ's body. And it's led not to further brokenness, but to wholeness and fullness. So it tells us here that he blessed. He broke, and then he gave. And this is Christ, right? He's always giving. He is giving to the people the things that they need. He's providing what they couldn't do on their own. He's exhausted. He is emotionally compromised, and yet his love continues to spill out and bless these people who had a need. Now, this is instructive for us, and it's comforting for us. It's instructive for us because it demonstrates the Jesus way. What is the Jesus way? To consider others better than yourself, to give away that which he has given to you, and then watch him multiply it as you continue to give back to him and give to those who have needs. It's instructive of us. It shows us what Christ does. We are servants to all. We love people and we love them in tangible ways. But then it's also comforting because it shows what he can do. If we're in that position where we're like, I'm in need, or we're in that position where we're like, I don't have enough, or we're in that position where we're like, God, I don't know how we're going to make the ends meet. These things aren't going to come together. We have the example here of one who can take those things that we think are not going to make it and stretch those things beyond what we can imagine. It's about what he can do in us and what he can do for us. He gives in our season of lacking. He gives in our season of need. In fact, he gives far more than what we ask or think. And that leads to the last observation, which is about an astounding result. If you look at verses 20 and 21, it says, and they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces that were left over. So two words I want to point out here as it relates to this astounding result. The word fullness and then the word abundance. So when we talk about fullness, it tells us everyone was full. Go back to That's Italian, where I've got my son and my nephew, and they're sitting here and they're eating, right? 10 pieces of garlic bread each. 10 pieces of garlic bread. That's a lot of bread. And then they turn around and they eat their entrees. On the other end of the table, you've got my parents who are older and they're splitting a meal, right? The needs, the perceived needs are very different between the voracious metabolism raging teenager that is literally throwing food in and somewhere, I don't even know where it's going, right? There's not enough physical room in their bodies to fit all the food that they've placed inside. And then on the other side, somebody who's just splitting a meal and pecking away with it. And somewhere in the middle is Calvin, and Calvin eats like a bird, like he eats two or three little things, and I'm full now. But what it tells us is that everyone, the people that had the voracious appetite versus the people who had no appetite, it tells all were satisfied. Everyone was satisfied. The Greek word that's used there is the Greek word kortazo, and what it means is to fill up or fatten. So if you've ever been to a restaurant and you've eaten everything that you should have eaten, and then you've gone that step more, and you're sitting here and you're going, oh, if I eat another bite, I'm going to pop. That's the word, right? To fill up or fatten. It is to come to that point of absolute fullness. That's what it means. From almost nothing, Jesus fills the bellies. From empty to full, from broke to blessed, Jesus demonstrates that he can stretch that which was given to him and placed in his hands in order to fill the tank of everyone who was there. You guys are in the same economy I'm in, so you probably have done this. You go to the gas station, and you're looking at it, and you're like, wow, that is almost $6 a gallon to fill this thing up. I'm just going to put $20 in and get myself from point A to point B, because I can't afford the $150 that it costs to fill it up, right? We've been in that position. Maybe not everybody here. Some of you guys are like high rollers, and you're filling the tank every time. But for us, $20 and $30 at a time is pretty common. And what Jesus does here is he doesn't just give them something just to eat, just to satiate their hunger for a moment. He fills that thing all the way up. We're filling the tank. Fullness is the word. But then we also have abundance. It goes a step further. And this is what it says. It says, and they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces. 12 baskets of leftover pieces. Now, when we talk about baskets, Jim was walking around earlier today and he had the little basket with the communion cups. That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is like these baskets here, these bushel baskets that they would make in the Middle East. And so there's 12 of these that are completely full of all the pieces that were left over after they had fed these thousands of people. What Jesus is showing this is I can fill the bellies of every person here, and I can go further, and I can give leftovers to fill the bellies of the people that couldn't make it, and fill the belly of the dog that you left at home, and to fill the belly of your neighbor next door. He's like, whatever it is that you need, I have more at my disposal than you can eat or burn through. Let me say that again. Jesus is showing these people, I have more at my disposal than you can eat or burn through. I have more at my disposal than you could possibly need, so much so that there is an overflowing of provision so that when it's done, there are 12 baskets of leftover pieces. There was an overflowing of blessing from Jesus for these people. And again, what is it that drives this? It tells us right at the beginning. Jesus got out and he saw these people and he saw those that had the heal, needed to be healed. And it says, and he had what? What's the word? Say it again. He had compassion. And the compassion of Jesus leads to the abundance of Jesus. His compassion, that welling up of pity and compassion that he has for people, leads to the abundance. And that's what we see in the text. When we look at this, we see a very powerful lesson at work, and that is that Jesus is not limited. He's not limited. Even the tiniest things that you place in his hands, he can turn those things to be exceedingly abundantly more than all you ask or think. That is who we serve, and that is who we follow. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, as Paul is talking, he's writing to the Corinthians about being cheerful givers. This is what he says. It's on the front of your bulletin as well, but it says, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all time, you may abound in every good work. God is able to make all grace abound to you. Let's own that this morning. Let's take that in. Let's let that be written on our hearts. He is able to make all grace abound to us so that in all things we may have sufficiency at all times so that we can abound in every good work. He fills us up so that we can go out and share the gospel, so that we can go out and live for him and we can lead others to him. These people who followed Jesus out in that desolate place, who were suddenly in need, they had Christ as their advocate and he filled them up to overflowing. And the same is true about us, that we follow this same Lord and he has the ability to fill us up to overflowing so that we may be able to accomplish the things that he has for us to accomplish. 9 years ago, our family stood on the precipice of the unknown with three words propelling us to move forward: fishes and loaves. Don't know why those were the three words that God chose to place on my heart, but those three words have run through my head just about every day over the past 9 years: fishes and loaves. The conviction that if God called us to go, God would provide what we need to get there, and he would provide what we needed when we got there. And all those years later, after we arrived here, God has proven himself faithful. As we look and see that he has provided, sometimes through people in this church, sometimes in other ways, he's provided the material things that we needed. And he has provided the people and the relationships, and he has grown the ministries of this church, and he has brought people together, and he has done exceedingly abundantly more than what we could have asked or thought back when we were sitting there wondering, can we make this happen? The answer to that question is no. No, we can't make it happen. But you know who can? Jesus can. And that's what we live on. That is our story. July of 2015, we don't know if we can pay you what you need to live here 9 years later. Look at everything that God has done and marvel at the one who is able to do far more than what we ask or think. Whatever your lack, whatever your need, you serve the one who has it all at his fingertips. So this morning, let's put our trust in him. Let's believe that if we don't have enough in our hands, that we serve a God who can make it enough. And if we're going through difficult things, we can even place those in his hands and trust that he is going to be our advocate and he is going to work and do things that astound us. Because that is who he is, a God who loves us, a God who has given himself for us, and a God who continually gives himself for us. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the truth of your word, Lord. We thank you that we can see in the story of the feeding of the 5,000 a model of your provision and a model of your goodness and your ability. And Lord God, I just pray that each and every one of us that's here this morning would be able and would be willing to trust you, that even in those times where we feel like we don't have what we need, or even in those times we're wondering where it's going to come from, that we can look to you and say, I don't know where it's coming from, but I know the one who holds the stars in his hands, and the one who moves the planets, and the one who created all things, and I can trust in that one. So Lord God, I thank you so much that we can trust in you and that we can depend on you, and that you again prove yourself faithful over and over. And so Lord God, let us be a people who depend on you for everything, because we know that you are able and you are faithful. We pray these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
I've got a friend closer than a brother. Thank you.
sufficient. So come if you're needing forgiveness or healing, His mercy is enough. Oh, this is our
Savior He is. We can trust, we can depend, because we know that He is able, and we trust that He is willing. Amen? So I'm going to end our service the way that we normally end our service, which is to take an offering. If the Lord has placed it on your heart to contribute to the ministries of this church, on either side of the door there, you will see a black receptacle. You can place it there. If this is your first time visiting with us this morning, take a moment before you leave. Fill out a connect card in the seat in front of you and drop that in the receptacles on the way out so that we've got a record of your visit. If you have questions about the church, we can answer those. I'll try to get back with you. I will not be in the office Monday or Tuesday this week, but on Wednesday I will get back to you and respond to those. We have a church council meeting in about 15 minutes up in the library. Have a wonderful week, and I will greet you at the door on the way out. Have a great week.